Okay, we're recording.
Okay. Rolling. So I guess we just start.
Yeah, I think we'll just dive in.
Just go right into it.
Yeah.
I'm J.W. Myers.
I'm Karl Brewdio.
And holy crap, it's the Movie Brewdio podcast with J.W. and Karl. We are two guys living in Western Maryland who love our small town lives yet cling to our past days of social and cultural relevance.
So in our podcast, we talk about the movies, the podcasts, and other resources that enable us to walk through life with a smile on our faces and a little bit of kindness in our hearts.
And
yes,
our podcast is on frickin' iTunes.
I know. Like,
it is.
And they know about it.
They know about it, like stuff got published, like there's a logo up there and stuff now. And what's funny is in the opening, I'm not sure I clearly said, it's the Movie Brewdio podcast. I think I said,
The Movie Brewdio podcast, you say. What an intriguing title.
Tell me more about that. Yeah. So after 8,000 weeks of doing this, we are finally, whatever it means to be a real podcast. I mean, you can't get any more, Mark Maron's WTF, it's on iTunes.
Right.
Tim Ferriss is
on iTunes.
Is on iTunes.
Right.
The Nerdist.
Right.
They're on iTunes.
My brother, me, on iTunes.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So it's a real podcast now.
Yeah.
Do you feel pressure?
Yeah. Yeah.
I do too.
I feel
like something's changed.
Feel like I don't know how to talk anymore.
I am completely it's like the first we did 6 weeks of practice,
right.
And then we did 12 weeks of real.
Yeah.
But there was still this, we're just going to throw it up on iTunes. But now, like, the difference is people that we don't actually know could actually listen to this.
Correct. And that is terrifying.
It's terrifying to me. Now it's got to work. Now the numbers have to go up at some point.
Yeah. Yeah, the pressure's really on. Because now I feel like so, what did you do this week? No, you go. I had the occasion to witness a cultural event that was good.
Well, listen.
Yeah.
So we have to do a real podcast now.
Yeah.
Because we have a website.
The
Movie Brewdio podcast. I can't even say the name of the business right. The Movie Brewdio podcast.com.
Yes.
Which is where they're all parked.
Indeed.
And it's not especially pretty, but it's there. And that's
right.
What iTunes, gets our RSS, I said it right?
Yes.
Feed off of, and it goes to iTunes,
right.
And I guess it goes everywhere else too. But, and there's also the moviebrewdio.com is also a website.
Right.
I struggled with them all week. And they are built now.
But you have wrestled them into shape.
I have wrestled those son of a gun. But it cost me money to buy the real estate for that.
Yeah.
So now money has been invested in this. So now we're playing for keeps. You bought a microphone before.
It's like you want me to feel as much pressure as possible.
Well, I do.
I think I'm trying not to throw up.
Listen,
because I'm a little nervous.
Listen, at some point, people are going to start subscribing.
Yeah.
To this podcast.
Oh, come on,
and
man.
So we really have to up our game.
Yeah. Well, okay. I'll do my best.
So I want to approach this as more of a business. Okay.
Right. Yeah.
So I think that because the Movie Brewdio podcast is like the foundational podcast of our movie studio.
Yeah, right. True.
Let's start approaching these podcasts like a business meeting.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
I'm on board with that. So you're like CEO and I'm like CFO? Are those real?
This is where it gets really uncomfortable, Karl.
Okay.
And I don't know how to bring this up, but I started the Movie Brewdio.
Right. That is true. Yeah.
I don't know what I've started, but I've started this. I've never actually hired you.
Yeah. Oh, well, yeah. Yeah, that is
so
true.
I feel
that
like we should do like, a job interview. That's my first executive order.
Okay.
As the CEO, I think that we need to hire you for this job.
Okay.
Because, we don't just give out jobs around here, Carl.
No, I get it.
You know, this is a real
business.
We don't just give out jobs.
I had a feeling that, this is what usually happens when people, people get to know me is eventually, they...
I'm going to take a completely objective view of this. It's like, I'm going to pretend like I don't know you.
Okay.
We're not friends.
Okay.
Our kids are not downstairs playing Minecraft together.
Right. Okay.
They don't go to the same school together. We're not on the same board together. This is just you walk into my office here.
Yeah.
This is a really professional. What are you? Why are you laughing at my office? If this were a real job interview,
right? No. I'm not laughing at the office. It's not. Well, I mean, we're in Jillian's bedroom, so that
All right. Listen, they didn't have to know that. And
that's true.
Yes. Okay.
So we're not in Jillian's bedroom.
We're not in Jillian's bedroom.
That part for sure.
There are no Littlest Pet Shops on a shelf behind you.
No.
Or girls' clothing.
No.
There are no puppies with sunglasses on a poster on the wall.
No, because that would be unprofessional.
Yeah, exactly. This is a serious office with a movie studio. So let's...
So just interview, just shoot from the hip, and I'll just answer honestly.
All right, so how are you today, sir?
Good.
We're shaking hands.
That's official. Want that on the record.
It was a good firm handshake.
Thank you.
I actually kind of gave a weak one there.
Yeah, bit of a dead fish.
I said, don't you hate that when you get a dead fish handshake?
I do it on purpose.
Yeah?
When I meet someone, I just go, hey, how you going? And I just kind of like...
What if both people do the dead fish? That is like we're kind of holding hands.
We're just gently caressing each other's palms.
My Uncle Jim was the one that taught me. He was an Army colonel. He's a retired Army colonel.
Right.
And he's one really taught me about a good firm handshake.
Go
I always try to do that.
See,
it's
the
just the
is,
angle was the problem.
Well, I think the problem is, I have small, like baby hands.
Uh-huh.
I've got, Donald Trump hands. Tiny hands. And so, when and my dad's got those big catcher mitt hands,
mm-hmm.
So I just don't have that ability to go in and really grab somebody's hand.
I'm going to let you off. I'm not going to judge you on it because it was an angle. Although your handshake was firm. Mine was the dead fish.
Right. Now,
that was the angle.
Teenage girls.
Yes.
Shake their hands all day. Right. Because
the
size different. It works in my, or little kids. I can shake the
heck out of
little kids.
So you're very impressive to teenage girls. I don't. This is a job interview.
It's a power move.
It's
not my fault. This is a well-documented power move. Okay, back to the interview.
All right, Carl, tell me about your why do you want to work for the movie Brewdio?
Okay. I ask myself that a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, first of all, I would say because I don't have a lot going on right now, and I got a lot of spare time on my hands.
So this job is like a last resort for you?
No, that is not what I'm saying.
Because there are a line of people
outside
the door, Carl,
Look,
that want a job here.
This is not my last resort. This is like my third resort. If it depends on how the Dollar General application goes. Because fingers crossed, cashier.
I get a lot of stuff at.
They do.
Yeah, I get a lot of stuff there. Yeah.
They're expanding their meat case,
mm-hmm.
which I think is really good.
I'm
excited about that.
Case at Dollar General.
Yeah, it's pretty good. You get benefits after 30 days. It's a pretty good gig, but not that the movie Brewdio isn't a good gig.
All right.
So what I really need more than anything is something to tell my parole officer. That I've been looking for meaningful employment because it's part of it's one of the conditions.
We're not really looking at that. That's
right.
Okay. But just out of curiosity, why do you have a parole officer?
Okay, look, it wasn't anything violent.
That's good.
I didn't do anything violent.
Mm-hmm.
But evidently now in the United States, it's illegal. For you to carry around a bunch of exotic animals in your trunk.
Okay.
Comrade.
What kind of animals were
there? Well,
uh-huh.
I had a marmoset.
Uh-huh.
I had two echidna.
Uh-huh.
Some prairie dogs.
What is echidna?
It's sort of a spiky kind of creature. I don't really recommend.
I don't know
those.
What echidna is.
Yeah, it's kind of a we'll spiky have to look thing. Up. Yeah, it's not good. Not cuddly.
Is it like a porcupine or
sorta kind of like that? Kind of meaner. It's a lot meaner.
Uh huh.
Bite you, stab you, and so probably wasn't a good choice for a petting zoo. But I thought I got it cheap, and I felt like that was a pretty good deal.
You know, they you know give us new pets all the time, right. so why not? Yeah.
So anyway, I got when they said open your trunk, and I did. Here's all these animals in little cages, and they all had food and water and beds, and they were totally like, I put a little flat screen TV in the trunk, and they were fine. And then they were like, hey, you can't keep these. And I was like, oh, why not? And they said they're exotic and they're against the law. So then, evidently, maybe, was it right, was it wrong to just let them out on the side of the road? I don't know. I mean, that's a judgment call. But I feel like if I was in that situation, I would do it again.
You're the worst job interviewer ever. This is probably you do, isn't it?
Yeah, I share a lot of personal information.
Yeah,
just completely unsolicited personal information, and I just go on and on and on about it.
Mm-hmm.
shameful things I did when I was a kid, really, like when I hurt people. I just tell on and on, like yeah. And then in senior high school, I did something really bad.
All right,
yeah.
Did you find any advertisers this week?
No.
Okay.
Well, the short answer is no. The long answer is also no. But I had some conversations with people where they did not knee me in the groin and tell me to leave their establishment.
Perfect.
And I think that's a moral victory. And that, I think, that's building on success from last week.
Yeah. Well, you've had a conversation with somebody last week.
No,
so far, of our advertising has been for products that aren't actually paying us to advertise for them.
That's true, yeah. Well, what I tried was
the mushroom tea.
What I tried to do was I tried some, like, reverse psychology. So, we talked a while back about, we mentioned McDonald's.
Right.
So I went to the local McDonald's in Cumberland. I went downtown to the downtown McDonald's, and I went in and I was like, hey, we talked about you on our podcast. And they were like, whoa, that's really cool. And I was like, you owe me $20.
Yeah.
And they wouldn't go for that for some reason.
And so then they
had to call the police. Anyway, I think, but we're making headway, and I'm confident that eventually we're gonna break through.
Yeah,
we're gonna break through. I feel it.
Did you do I sent Headspace along to you. Did you do Headspace? Speaking of people who don't pay us for advertising
that's right.
for them,
I did. I looked at Headspace, but I haven't figured out what time in my day to do it.
You're never gonna do this.
I have
15 or 16 days straight in.
Really?
I actually paid them.
Wow.
And I paid them, and then they sent me something to give you 30 days free.
Which I appreciate.
After I paid them, I'm like, well, why didn't you send me that 30 days
free?
No,
well, they already got your money, so.
Oh, man.
Yeah, I mean, now they want me to pay. Mm-hmm. But little do they know, I ain't paying for nothing,
Summers. I'm going to hit them up and see if we can...
write them a letter.
Yeah, write them a
letter. We've been talking about Headspace a lot.
We've been talking about Headspace a lot.
You owe me $100.
I think they should appreciate that.
I think so. Absolutely.
GoDaddy.
And you can say now we're on iTunes.
Yeah.
You can say... Do you know who you're talking to?
Yeah.
The Movie Brewdio Podcast. We're on iTunes. Maybe you've heard of us. Be really conceited about it.
So you mentioned whenever we were talking out there, you said that you have seen a couple of movies this week.
Yes, it's so strange because we usually talk and I have to rack my brain about stuff that I've seen.
Uh-huh.
But yeah, I've seen two movies in the past week, which is really like grown-up movies. Not I almost said adult movies, but grown-up movies.
I've seen several adult movies this week. Right.
See, two adult movies, five adult movies and two grown movies. No, so I saw, which one do you want me to start with?
The less great one.
Oh, man, that's...
They were both really great?
They were both great in their own
way. I bet
you
I can guess one of the ones you saw.
They're very different. If you guess, and if you get it right, I'll talk about that one.
Logan.
I did see Logan.
Yes, I knew it, because you're a comic book guy. Yeah. So
yes,
of course
I did
you saw
see
Logan.
I went with my friend Mark, my friend Adam.
Uh-huh.
We went Monday night and saw Logan, and it was... I think it will redefine how superhero movies get made, to be honest. Because it is so... It's a movie that happens to have superheroes in it, right?
Uh-huh.
Or like, not even superheroes. It's like it's a movie, and there are people in it who have superpowers.
Right.
But the plot of the movie is much more like a... It's like a... Almost like a bank heist movie or something where you've got two guys who are going to pull off one more job. And so the takes place in the future. Logan is a spoiler alert. He's old. He's sort of fallen apart for various reasons. I won't spoil what. And he's working as a chauffeur in El Paso, driving people around and for money. And Professor X is super old, and there's been some incident, and he's Logan's keeping him across the border in Mexico.
This is where it gets so confusing because he exploded several movies ago.
Yes, okay.
He exploded.
I actually
and then sometimes he's now.
I had to actually watch a video that talks about the timelines. Mm-hmm. So if you have seen all the most recent X-Men movies,
I've been trying to watch Apocalypse and I can't get through it.
I can't. Apocalypse was a movie that when we watched it, Adam and I watched it together, and literally, it sounds like an adult movie if you just close your eyes. There's so much grunting and sort of furtive
like
moaning.
An actual adult movie.
Yes, I mean, and there's a lot of face touching.
Yeah,
like because there's so much psychic battles, and everyone when there's a psychic battle, they touch each other's face.
And,
then
we know we're going into their head.
Right.
It's a
lot of face touching and groaning. So. Anyway, so
what kind of adult movies are you watching?
Facetoucher.com. So anyway, so what happens is if you've seen all the most recent X-Men movies, there's Days of Future Past where they send.
I saw that one.
They send Logan's consciousness into the past, and he stops Mystique from killing the Trask guy.
Right.
And so that changes the future. So basically what that means is that the original X-Men, X2, X3, and like the first two Wolverine movies technically never happened because it changed the timeline. But some of those events kind of, I guess, have leaked through from one timeline to another because they reference some of that stuff in Logan. But Professor X is alive, but he has some sort of degenerative brain disease.
Right.
And so he keeps having these episodes where he's almost killing people with his powers. So then there are no more mutants being born, but then it turns out that there's this girl who turns out to be a mutant, and they're trying to get her from El Paso to Canada,
right,
where there's like a sanctuary. It's like an asylum for mutants in Canada. And so they're being tracked by all these different forces, and it's a really interesting. I mean, it is definitely an R-rated movie. Like,
right.
Do not take your children. I saw a couple parents with like, you know, Ethan age kid.
But there's a little girl. He has a little girl Wolverine, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
That was in the trailer.
Yes.
That looked really cool.
It is phenomenal, and the language is pretty rough, and it's very like. I mean, it's not sort of like when you watch the X-Men movies, you see Wolverine slashing people, but it's all fairly bloodless, and you go like, "Oh yeah, I bet that really looks bad."
Yeah,
and in
that
this,
kind of hurts that he just
and
sliced
in this,
your intestines out.
Yeah, and in this, it's like cutting people's arms off and like
sweet,
like stabbing them in the head with the claws. And
yeah,
I mean, it's pretty brutal.
Mm-hmm.
And it just has you know, this is the last film that Patrick Stewart and Hugh Jackman are going to be Professor X and Logan, respectively. And so this is a way to send off their characters. And so, you know, not to spoil it, but they, you know, the way they wrap those characters up, I think it works
really,
really well.
Was satisfying.
Yes, it works really, really well.
Satisfying, yeah.
But it works. I think you could largely strip out the superhero parts of it. You could rewrite that movie and change a couple of the concepts. And it could easily stand up as just a science fiction movie.
Yeah.
It could stand up as
well. A good film's a good film. A good story's a good story. Yeah. And that's what it always.
Yeah. I mean, it could stand up as almost like a crime caper sort of film. It was very, very good.
Can't wait to see. That's one I actually do want to see. We were looking for something to see.
Yeah.
But we needed to take the kids, so I'm glad we didn't take the kids.
And James Mangold, the director, he's talked about doing what they did with the last Mad Max movie, Fury Road, which was do a black and white version of it, which would be fantastic. I mean, it would translate, I think, really well to black and white.
I didn't realize they did a black and white version.
I don't know if they did. They released some footage that was black and white because he said he wanted to do it in black and white. He wanted it to be like a, you know.
Interesting.
Which is really weird because when you watch Fury Road, it's super saturated. Mm-hmm. The color is really incredibly saturated. Yeah. That's what he said. He always wanted to do a black and white version. So it was very, very good. So then the other movie that we saw. And I won't disclose how I saw it, but we saw the other night La La Land.
Okay, all right.
And I see why it won Best Picture.
Yeah. No. Yes.
No, and I will actually say that's not specifically true because I thought it was good. It doesn't really go anywhere. Like it.
Yeah, that seemed to be the criticism of it, is that it kind of starts out good as a musical. Numbers are catchy.
It's a very small story. Uh-huh. Like, if you were to strip out the musical elements of it, and it was just the story of Emma Stone and Ryan Gosling meeting, you know, you could tell that story very simply because nothing really happens. They meet a couple times, it doesn't work. Then they meet, and they sort of fall for each other a little bit.
Uh-huh.
Then they go through, you know, then they get together and then they're together and then they sort of get pulled apart. And then at the end, they kind of come back together. So it's a very by the numbers kind of romance. But the way that it's done, I mean, it starts off with a big musical number on like whatever the interstate is going into LA, the big interstate.
Right.
And it's this huge, big musical number. So it starts off strong.
Like, yeah.
And it starts off, this is what you're in for.
Mm-hmm.
This is what it's going to be. And, you know, I don't know. It doesn't feel like a musical in that there's certainly music in it.
Mm-hmm.
And there are musical numbers in it. But it's not like a Broadway musical where it's, where it's a song every page and a half. You know, it's like song, a little, you know, scene and a half, you know, two scenes. Song, half a scene, song, you know, it doesn't follow that structure.
Did you like it?
I did like it because it's very, I liked it probably more from a technical perspective.
Right.
Because of the way that they do it.
Because the singing and dancing was.
The singing and dancing was really good, but there's a part where they're trying to, Emma Stone's living in this apartment with like three other girls and they want to go to this party, this Hollywood party. And they're trying to convince her to go, and she's just come back from an audition, and she's tired. And they're trying to convince her, you know, come on, come on. And it's this musical number in the apartment, and it's all one take. It's a one.
Oh, wow.
Right? And so the camera's, you know, in a room, and it backs out, and it comes down the hallway, and then it turns into another room, and they do another section. And then it kind of goes back up the hallway and goes into another room, and it's this really finely orchestrated,
so,
you know, choreographed thing.
So is it, do you think, was it really done one take or was it made to look seamless as if it were done in one take?
I think it was one take. I think it was really done one take.
That's pretty tough to pull off.
It's pretty
particularly
ambitious.
In a higher budget feature like that.
And then
a lot of people to move around.
When they go outside, you know, she decides that she wants to go. And then when you get outside, you can see, like, the concept is on display all the way around. So there are these four girls, and they're all in. One girl's wearing a yellow dress, one girl's wearing a red dress, one has a blue dress, one has a green dress.
Uh-huh.
And they're doing a musical number and a dance, you know. Mm-hmm. It is, it's lit. The movie is lit phenomenally.
Uh-huh.
The lighting is just incredible. And the color, like the art direction in it, is astounding. And every scene has sort of a really bold color choice. And it's not necessarily, they're not changing the whole palette. It's not like, well, in this scene, you know, we went with reds, and in this scene, we went with greens. It's really like, in this scene, it's a regular scene, but the lighting on, like, this building is this color, you know, and it, so it really jumps out at you.
Now, is it, like, would you normally comment about the lighting or the production design of a film? Is this something normal, or you just, it really stood out to you?
When I was watching it, I was sort of like, I know what I'm in for here. I understand what the movie is going to be. And it's cute. It has its, it has its fun moments, and, you know, there's some moments of romance and stuff. It didn't affect me emotionally enough where I was really sucked into it. So I was probably more cognizant of how it was made.
How are you with musicals in general?
I actually really love musicals.
What is your favorite musical?
You know, my favorite musical is probably, well, I love Hamilton. Everybody loves Hamilton.
Sure. I guess I should qualify that and say, what is your favorite classic musical?
Favorite classic musical. I would have to say my favorite classic musical is, that's tough. I love Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat. I like Annie, Get Your Guns Okay. I don't like the really old musicals, like Oklahoma never did much for me.
No.
But then
did you like Cabaret?
Cabaret's good.
I like Cabaret a lot.
Yeah.
We did that in college.
I like Bye Bye Birdie is a good show.
We did that recently around here, and that one seemed really dated whenever I saw it recently.
It's very,
like, all the performances were really good, but the show still didn't really get me.
I think there are some sort of those mid-century shows that don't age well. They don't age in the way that The King and I ages, or
right. The King, you know, the Mark's group, Acting Out for ALS, did King and I last year. It was really good.
Yeah.
And,
so
I thought it really held.
Yeah, we did. Like, I'm trying to think. Like, Sound of Music's okay. I love modern musicals, so I really like, I liked Rent when it first came out. Rent has not aged well.
No. I mean, that was about a time.
It was a very specific, because everyone now, the entire cast would be on antiretiral medicine.
And
they would sort of be managing
a moment there.
They would be managing their illness. I mean, it's just a different time. It was a time where AIDS was a death sentence, and so it was it was a specific kind of thing. But
I am a fan of the modern, like you mentioned Hamilton. Book of Mormon is just
Mormon's a great show. Avenue Q
is a masterpiece.
I love
Spamalot. Spamalot's really great.
I love Hedwig and the Angry Inch is a great show. Fantastic show. It's probably my favorite. I would say it's probably my favorite.
I remember,
outside of Hamilton,
I saw the movie so long ago, and it didn't hit with me when I saw it, the movie version of Hedwig. So I'd like to see it again.
The stage version is, the stage version translates and I think hits you harder than the movie does. It's the kind of show that's very hard to translate to a movie. Because it's a show, the show is presented as a performance.
Like, right.
You go in to see the show, Hedwig and the Angry Inch, and it's the band, Hedwig and the Angry Inch, playing a concert for you and telling stories and vignettes and, you know.
Interesting.
Yeah,
did you see the Green Day musical,
American Idiot?
American Idiot.
I have not seen it, so I don't know. Yeah.
They just actually did it around here recently.
Yeah.
I did not get out to see it.
I don't know.
I love all the music involved. I love Green Day.
I think some of it too gets to a point where you go, like, everything now gets turned into a musical because you can squeeze some money out of fans, and that's why you have School of Rock gets made into a musical, and, you know, whatever. But
they also did a Netflix behind the scenes of American Idiot or the development of it and stuff. And that was quite interesting.
Yeah. So I think with La La Land, I think it didn't pull me in as a musical. And I'll give an example. Another musical that I love, we went to see the movie version of it, and I was not super excited about it. We go in and, you know, we sit down, and it's me And our girls were young. I think it was before Ethan was born. So our girls are, Chelsea's 16 probably, mm-hmm. and so Beth is, you know, 7 or 8.
Yeah.
Our youngest daughter. And so we go in, and like my mother-in-law's there, and they wanted to see this movie, and I was like, oh, here we go. So we go in and we sit down, and the movie comes up, and it's Hairspray, right? The movie. And it starts with boom, 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 boom,
yeah.
boom, boom.
Yeah.
And like as soon as that started, I was like, okay, I'm in.
Yeah,
like
through the whole thing. Yeah.
And from that point on, I was like, I'm totally into this. I can't deny it. Like it was, and it was so good. The music's so good.
The musical was actually better than the film it was based on.
Yeah.
And it just went the direction it needed to go. Now, when they did that, they did Hairspray Live just a couple months ago.
Yeah.
It was really good.
Yeah.
And it was because it had come right after Rocky Horror,
right.
Which was just, it was unwatchable bad. The version that they did on Fox was unwatchable bad.
We'll swing back to that.
Okay.
So let me finish my thought on La La Land, though. But when it comes to La La Land, I was very aware of sort of how it was made and how it was put together. But
uh-huh.
there's a scene where they go, they have a date where they meet to watch at the El Rey Theater or whatever. They
uh-huh.
they go to see Rebel Without a Cause.
Okay.
And so it's one of the, it's sort of like their third meet cute where she has this other engagement. Is she going to break it to meet him at the movie theater, which she does. And so they go to see Rebel Without a Cause, and the scene where they go to Griffith Observatory.
Yeah.
The film breaks.
Mm-hmm.
And so he goes, I've got an idea. And so they drive up to the observatory, right?
Gotcha.
And they go in, and the thing is lit just tremendously, and it's kind of sunset, you know, and it's like that, you know, beautiful mm-hmm. kind of orange sky. And they go in and they're going around and they go in the planetarium
uh-huh.
and they turn on like the planet, like the show in the planetarium. And then, and there's numerous things. The other thing about the lighting is that they use lighting for dramatic effect.
Right.
So there's a lot of scenes where they need to isolate two characters. So what they'll do is they'll lower the lights around
mm-hmm.
and put two people in spotlight, like you would do on stage.
Right.
Right, to highlight these two characters, you know, to single them out as the rest of the scene's going. So some of it is sort of a heightened reality as well. They're in the observatory and there's stars. And so Ryan Gosling takes Emma Stone's hand and sort of lifts her up, and she starts floating up into the
uh-huh.
up into the stars. And so they float up into the stars and they're doing this kind of dance sequence.
Right.
And then it goes to, you know, it's full widescreen, just this galaxy of stars,
mm-hmm.
incredibly vivid color, and they're dancing in silhouette, and it's so beautiful, like the way that they
mm-hmm.
they do this whole routine, they as they dance, and the silhouettes kind of come closer, and that was the moment where I was like, this is a really beautiful film.
What
it doesn't, you know,
me,
I mean, again, like there were scenes that affected me, there were scenes where I was really into it.
And were you emotionally gripped? That's what you seem to be dancing around. It doesn't seem like you were, like, it seems to me like one of those ones where, like, I really, really wanted to like this, and I see everything that's brilliant about it.
Right.
But it didn't have that.
You believe the relationship between the two characters.
Mm-hmm.
The story itself
And she won Best Actress.
Yes.
Yes.
The story itself is just not, there's just not much there. There's just not much there.
So it's a failure
know?
Of the writing, performance,
yeah.
direction, all the technical aspects.
Performance, direction, the technical aspects are fantastic.
And even the music was the music.
The music is good. The music is very good.
So it's really just kind of a basic story failure.
Yeah, the story.
What if you call anything a failure about it, it didn't fail at all.
The story itself is a very, it's not like, you don't get the sense that these two are These aren't like two people who are destined to be together and they have to fight through all of these things. Like,
and let me ask one question. They're both in show. She wants to be an actress and he's a jazz musician.
And he wants to open his own club.
This was independent filmmaking 101.
Right.
And it was, don't make a movie about making movies.
Yes.
Nobody wants to know what it's really like to make movies.
Right.
And it's a basic story flaw because there has to be, it's kind of like when you're making a movie, like when you're writing a script, you can't make references to other movies.
Right.
It's like that movie, you know, that fantasy world has to exist outside
right.
of us Otherwise, we can't enjoy the fantasy. And I think it sounds to me like it kind of fails on that.
And level. I think there is, like, it wears its influences on its sleeve dramatically. I mean, like, it is very much a throwback to old 50s Hollywood musicals. Mm-hmm. Like, the structure of it, the way it's shot, the way it's put forward. They do a couple dance numbers that are dressed up. Like, you could make it look like a real location, but they make it look almost like a real location, so you can kind of tell it's a back lot.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And, like, you can mask that now. There's not that sense of, like, when you watch old movies, you go, like, that's happening on a back lot. That's the same back lot that was in this movie or this movie. You can hide that now through second unit footage. You can, or digitally, you can insert stuff and change stuff. But they didn't. They didn't do any of that. And I think it was to mimic that aesthetic. It was an aesthetic choice to give you that feel of, this is happening on a back lot, and we're putting on a show, and here we, you know, that. So it's a little too precious for me, I think. It's a little too, like, nudge, nudge, wink, wink. We love old musicals. Like, I love old musicals, too.
Why don't you just make a movie?
You're right. And so, I don't know. It's not to say I didn't enjoy it. I thoroughly enjoyed it, and I thought it was very good. And it did not move me. It did not affect me emotionally the way that I sort of thought it would. Huh. And I will point out, like, there's a movie, like, if you watch Walk the Line, right? Joaquin Phoenix and Reese Witherspoon.
Mm-hmm.
The Johnny Cash story.
Yes.
Where that romance really, you believe that relationship.
Yeah.
And the give and the you take gotta and put the that, push you and get, the pull you, and the, you know.
Yeah. But that's just two actors that really pulled it off there, particularly Reese. Yeah.
And that story is really compelling because it's, you know, you're following Johnny Cash, and I mean, it's a real story, and maybe that's the difference. They meet, they're sort of friends. Well, they sort of fall in love. They can't be together. There's longing. It pushes, it pulls, it pushes, it pulls. And then finally, they get together. You know, and so it follows that arc of how a real relationship happens.
Now, I'm really interested in seeing this now, simply because it's something I teach my students a lot, is about getting that emotional core right. And if you don't get that emotional core right, it's not going to work. And it sounds like they did everything perfect, but for you, that emotional core is not there.
It just didn't connect.
Yeah.
It just didn't connect with me. Not on that level. And I think you would probably really enjoy it. If you watched it once just as, I'm just going to watch this as a movie experience, and then you went back and you watched it as a director, I think as a moviegoer, you would go, that was good. It was a cute movie. And I think as a director, you would go, it's really astounding. You know, it's weird because it's sort of the opposite of how you typically, usually I watch a movie and I go, that was really good. I wonder why. And then I start deconstructing it and going, oh, well, they did this and they did this. And these are all the artistic choices they made to present this movie.
Well, see,
and this, I was doing the opposite, you know.
You know, oddly enough, joking around, I mean, Moonlight, the one that, you know, won Best Picture, that to me is what, you know, well, spoiler alert, they made a movie about a homosexual gangster, essentially, drug dealer.
Right.
And in really, but they established this emotional core so strongly. It's like, you put two things together, it's like, wait, what? Does that I've never seen a movie about that before.
It sounds sensationalistic. Like, they're just what? Like, he's a gangster, but he's also gay. And you're like, oh, wait, no, that's incredible. Yeah.
But
it's not that.
It's not that at all. But, you know, all the other elements was there. I mean, it was brilliantly directed.
Right.
But the casting, it went through the years, and the way they really got that emotional core right, where you're on the journey with this character.
Right.
So, and that's the one that actually did win Best Picture. So, very interesting.
So it was very interesting.
I can't say anything about La La Land. I have not seen it. There's Oscar coming for a visit. Yes. If you hear the table shake.
The microphone shake.
Yeah, that's happened. I've need the table a few times. So, I watched no movies this week.
Right.
I have consumed some media this week.
Oh, good. Okay.
And the one thing I did, something we talked about last week, I Netflixed binge watched Schitt's Creek.
Oh yeah. Okay.
Which is the it's not, I did not just curse.
Right.
It is Schitt's Creek.
Right.
Eugene Levy and Catherine O'Hara.
Man, oh man.
And what's his name? Chris Elliott.
Oh right.
Is
yeah.
another one
yeah.
in it, and Eugene Levy's son. And I loved it. And
I'll have to watch it.
But I gotta tell you, there's nothing that's particularly special about it.
Right.
There's nothing particularly special, and it's not particularly original or anything like that. I mean, the plot is right out of Arrested Development, but not really. It's
right.
like it's like a more grounded, real version of Arrested. It's a bunch of you know, a rich family that loses it all, but somewhere along the line they had it had purchased a town in Canada. And they lose everything, and they go to live in the town that they own. And it's the snobby rich folks in the country town that
right.
Just they can't get any of their the pleasures of life that they're accustomed to. And it's like it's so cliche,
right?
And it completely works in spite of itself because all the characters are completely endearing. And you just love watching these masters at work.
Right.
Gene Levy's son, his name's escaping me, has done a really good job of keeping just enough of Gene and Catherine O'Hara in it to engage us in the younger people story
right.
that's going on. I got through season one and half of season two, and I really like it. I can't
I'll
say
have
enough.
To watch it. Yeah,
it's just pleasant and you know good. That's while I was struggling with websites and everything, and trying and failing
yeah.
everything I was doing this weekend.
I say I went back and found some old, watched some old SCTV.
Uh huh.
And I just remember I had forgotten how good.
Uh-huh.
That stuff was.
Oh,
and
yeah.
it was Andrea Martin I couldn't think of last week.
Oh, yeah, Andrea Martin.
Andrea
yeah.
Martin. And it was,
Who reemerged in My Big Fat Greek Wedding.
Yes.
Was, my wife got into that movie. I think she saw it 100 times.
and it wasn't Edna. It was Edith, what was her name?
You forgot it again.
Oh, I forgot it again. But anyway.
We're not going to look it up.
No. It's interesting when you watch that show, too, because it went through so many different permutations.
Uh-huh.
There was the early, because it was made in Canada,
mm-hmm.
and they were getting funded by, I guess, the CBC, and
right.
so they never really knew from season to season what was going to happen, were they going to get renewed, for how much,
right.
until they went to NBC for a couple seasons, and they were doing 90-minute shows, like
right.
they were, the Network 90 shows. And the cast changed, so it started with Joe Flaherty and Eugene Levy, Catherine O'Hara, Dave Thomas, Andrea Martin, and Harold Ramis.
Uh-huh.
And then, Harold Ramis leaves, and Rick Moranis comes
yep.
in. And you forget how good Rick Moranis was. Like,
oh,
he
my
was
God, yeah.
so funny.
And he's, like, kind of gone away from the business, sort of.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
he apparently recorded a country album a
yeah,
year or
I
two ago.
So, yeah.
I think he was on The Nerdist a couple years ago. There's an interview with him
right.
out there. But he's just very different. And he, well, you know, he got those three Honey, I Shrunk the... something
oh, yeah,
movie
yeah, yeah.
so he got some serious Disney
money and he said
it was
I think
kind of like he went and raised his kids
and he said like they said do you regret you know
mm-hmm.
what happened with your life and he was like no I went and raised my kids it's what I wanted to do like that
yeah.
was there's no reason to regret that
yeah.
which I thought was an incredibly mature thing to such a healthy attitude to have about it.
Yeah, it's like wait a minute, you're uncommonly healthy for a
right?
Hollywood
like,
personality.
How did that happen?
Don't understand that. Yeah.
And I will throw that out as another musical, Little Shop of Horrors. The film version.
Oh my God, the film version of that was wonderful.
Yeah. But oh, you know that mm-hmm. so it brings me back to the Rocky Horror remake. which was cuz we went and saw Rocky mm-hmm. Horror with David Rohrbaugh and Eve did the Rocky Horror Picture Show through Allegheny Allied Arts, which,
mm-hmm.
if you don't know Allegheny Allied Arts, come see us at Oscar's Restaurant the first Monday of every month for the film lab.
Mm-hmm.
But they always do Rocky Horror at the Windsor Castle in Cumberland. So we went and saw Rocky Horror, like, I think the remake was on a Thursday, and we watched the original on Saturday night.
Uh-huh.
So there was a little bit of a gap between the two to kind of process what had happened. And I said...
to process the tragedy.
And I asked I asked Dave about it, and I was like, what did you think? And he was like, well, you know, when you won't put Rocky in, like, the skimpy, like, the gold Speedo.
Yeah.
You've got him in gold boxer shorts.
Yeah.
What's the point?
Yeah, yeah.
Why even bother with the rest of the remake? What's the point? You know, if you're too timid about that, like, because that's part of the whole concept. If you're
right.
too timid about that, what are you doing, you know? But it's like, well, we got the license to it, so we gotta, you know,
yeah,
scrape a couple dollars out of it.
Yeah, I thought the whole thing was just.
I felt bad for kids who were going to watch it for the first time
and think that that's what it was,
you know, and that they were going to go, because I think some kids are going to walk away going, that really wasn't much of anything, or they were going to say like, oh, that was so good, and are going to watch the original and go, what is this?
They're now, I'm a different. Little different from you. I'm not a huge fan of the original. I like cult followings of anything.
Right.
And I think it's certainly fun, but I think it's definitely a movie that falls apart 40 minutes into it.
It's
30,
not.
40 minutes.
You
There's some good numbers.
Yeah, you can't look at it as... You can't,
right.
You can't expect it to hang together as a narrative.
I expect a movie to hang together as a narrative.
Yeah,
that's,
I think
that's the problem.
I think that's why it disappoints. I think if you approach it as sort of like watching Eraserhead or like a fever dream. Where
yeah.
You're like, what's happening in this film?
Yeah.
That's what, and that was the thing I've said before. The thing that was so interesting to me is it felt dangerous. It was the first movie that I'd ever seen.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That felt like,
uh-huh,
this is gonna turn into a snuff
something,
film.
Something.
This is gonna turn into a snuff film. This is gonna turn into a porno. This is gonna turn into
something.
This is gonna take a turn at some point. And it's that sense of unease,
uh-huh,
that I, because it, none of those things happen. But you're on edge, like...
I'm not sure what I'm watching.
I don't, you know, it's the same thing as, you know, like when you're watching a Mystery Science Theater,
uh-huh,
and you're watching this movie and they're, you know, making comments on it, and you just see this film and it's like, this is so incompetently done.
Mm-hmm.
Anything could happen. This thing could go in any direction. It's not... You don't have the feeling like the director has complete control of this train. It's like this train is a runaway train and it's going downhill and anything can happen.
Is it possible to, I mean, do we live in a culture now with too much, is it possible to create that in any situation now? It's like we live in a culture that has too much information.
There's
too much available to
you. You know, I think the problem is, like, you can't, I don't know there's a way to shock people necessarily, or I don't know there's a way to give them that experience, because
mm-hmm,
we live in a spoiler rich society where
mm-hmm
information
mm-hmm
is instantly available, anything
yes
you want to know about any movie, so there's not that sense of discovery of like, I
nope
saw this movie like the first time I saw 1000 Maniacs, the Herschel Gordon Lewis film, which is about as crudely and cheaply done as you can do, but it is I mean, he made a purposeful decision to like make the goriest, bloodiest, nastiest movie
right
like that you could possibly make, and on, you know, a budget of $5,000 or whatever.
Right.
So it's just, they're really like, the performances are really wooden and they're not especially good. The special effects are
mm-hmm
the special effects are not incredibly convincing. But it's just there's just overall this sense of like, why would you do this? Like, it's so hard to make a movie. It's so hard to make it turn out. And you would put that much effort into making this? Like,
yeah,
that, like, why would you would put all that effort into making something that is this unpleasant and this just disgusting and like is just so crudely done,
well,
you know?
I can't hang with those kind of
you see that, like, I saw that film basically having read, you know, a paragraph about it in
mm-hmm
like the Psychotropic Film Guide, you
mm-hmm
know, and that's it. It's like, you know, vacationers stumble on a you know, this It's like a Brigadoon, this southern
right.
town that shows up in the backwoods in Georgia, and they stumble into it, and they're basically then all just killed and mutilated, and, you know, and then the town disappears.
Right.
And so you read the synopsis, and you go, okay.
Yeah.
And then you see it, and you just go, like, what is this?
Well,
what?
Is that, I mean, you know, we had that a few years ago with the human centipede phenomenon.
Right.
I mean, the first one is actually, you know, kind of a, I mean, it's really sick and disgusting and all those kind of things, but, you know, you got to go, well, you know, here's a premise I haven't watched before.
Right.
Now, you know, there was a 2 and I think a 3 and some problems with financing or.
Right, yeah, yeah.
And I heard some of, you know, what he did in 2, and I was like, what? I don't even want to watch that.
No, I have no. I've not seen any of them. I had no interest, but I don't know. To me, it's like, you know, there's a line. I think like there's this film Solo. Have you ever seen Solo?
No.
You would remember if you'd seen Solo. I've never seen. I've seen clips of it and stills and stuff, but it's basically 120 Nights of Sodom. Like the Marquis de Sade wrote this book,
right?
Of just utter depravity, you know, and they made a movie about it. But the director made a movie that was an allegory for the fascist Italian government during World War II.
Okay.
And so the concept is essentially, this is like what happens to all these characters when they're being degraded and they're being, you know, like, you know, mutilated and killed. This is psychologically and emotionally and spiritually what the fascist Italian government did to the people of Italy. And that's sort of this overarching, you know, concept.
What year was the movie made?
I want to say late 70s. And it's like, the clips I've seen are like, just, I don't know how to describe them. I mean,
okay. All right. Well, now I'm
like, what you,
vaguely
like,
interested.
What I've seen of it is so incredibly unpleasant that I can't imagine sitting down and watching it and going like, you know, I want to see this. I just want to sit down and just, and it's long. It's like 2 hours, 2.5 hours,
yeah.
You know. But again, it's like there was this artistic purpose behind it, you know. And they were trying to convey an idea that they could only convey with this other idea, you know. Like, you could say the fascist government in Italy was really bad, but when you like to present it and then go, I understand what you're doing. So I don't know. It's I don't know that you can do that today. I don't know. And that's what I'm saying. The other thing is, I think because you have access to real, actual stuff, you know, like you can find, if you really want to see someone get their head cut off, you can actually see a real person die. Like there's no way that, you know, it's the same thing as the, what was the theater in Paris where they would do the I can't remember how to pronounce it, but what they did was, starting in the 1850s, they would do these incredibly, they would do these shows, and it was always like, brother and sister get lost in the woods, you know, or are orphaned in the streets, and they get taken in by this guy who kills them and eats them, you know, and it was like this visceral sort of, you go and just go, oh, you know, it was one of the horror movies before horror movies. This was live, you know, it was happening on stage.
They didn't actually kill them.
No.
Okay.
No, they didn't actually
kill thought them. That's where you
no,
were
no,
going
sorry,
with
no,
it
no.
as we were having the, a live
no,
presentation
but it was this,
of
No, it was this,
of,
it was,
killing.
It was this show to present
right.
these terrible, terrible things.
Mm-hmm.
And it went all the way through the 40s, but they said, they stopped right after World War II because they said, there's no way that we can compare with the reality of Auschwitz. Like, there's no way that we could ever show you anything that is more terrible than something that actually happened. You know, the reality of this thing. And I think we're kind of there. I mean, like, you can do terrible, terrible stuff. But I don't know that you can get...
Well,
you know,
but see, that's where, you know, again, I'm developing a horror film
right
now. And you have to find a way that you can emotionally or psychologically grip people into it.
Right.
You know, just being able to, you know, it's... we all know how to portray someone getting their arm cut off, someone getting their head cut off, someone right. having horrible things done to the body. Like that, right. that can be filmed. There's a technical effect. There's a way to present that as real. But if you haven't gripped your consumer, if you haven't gripped your audience,
right.
if you haven't gripped them emotionally, if you haven't gripped them psychologically, if you haven't gotten, you know, back to where we started, a good story is a good story.
Good story is
and
a good
you,
story.
And you have to bring people into a good story. Otherwise, we're not going, you know, we're no more impressed with all the flash and the dazzle that you can provide.
Well, and I think like the, I think one of the scariest movies or the most unsettling movies for me was Rosemary's Baby.
Yeah.
Where
yeah.
you don't really see anything.
Uh-uh.
Like, you don't, it's all, no. you know, and because no. you don't see it.
Because you're there with her. You know, they bring, you know, I don't want to glorify Polanski, but
no.
he was, you know, at that time a really brilliant filmmaker.
Right.
And he really brought you into the Mia Farrow character that you cared about, this right. young, innocent mother that you could relate to.
Right.
That found herself, you know, in the midst of this series of events. And, I mean, it was.
Right. And because they don't show,
they
don't show you, so your mm-hmm. mind fills in the gap of what of all the terrible stuff mm-hmm. that she's, you know, yeah. they don't show you the baby,
yeah,
at the end, even though it's it should be, you know, terrifying.
Ultimately, and see, that's where things go wrong with me, because ultimately your mind can conjure images,
yes,
that your imagination can conjure images and conjure fear far worse than any graphic image that we can present to you,
yes,
and that's to me, that's what worked about the Blair Witch Project.
Yeah,
we got
right,
so
yeah.
little visually. They were psychologically manipulated by it. Everything they've tried to do since then hasn't worked, because they can show you stuff now because they have money for effects.
Right.
Now, you know, Paranormal Activity.
Right.
Apparently, did you see the original one?
I don't think so, but I know, I mean, it's culturally, I know.
I watched it, and I actually quite liked it all the way through, because we're there with the character.
Right.
What happened, and as I understand, and I apologize if I'm telling the story wrong, because this is the way that I heard the story, but they went to Sundance, whatever, where the film got bought, and basically, at the very end, I can't remember, the couple die, they get
right.
killed, whatever, and but everything is shot from the, you know, security camera
right.
watching the bedroom.
Yeah.
Anyway, at the very end of the version that I didn't see it at Sundance, I saw it once it was commercially available and had become a phenomenon. But basically, at the very end, we see the entity that's been haunting them the whole thing time.
Right.
Enter the room and you come at the camera, and then it
right.
goes black.
Yeah.
That apparently wasn't in the when they originally presented the film. The version I heard was that Spielberg said,
yeah.
"Hey, we want to see the Blair Witch. We want to see
right.
the Paranormal Activity
yeah.
Thing." And to me, it completely ruined the movie for me, because
I would agree with
ooh,
that. Yeah,
yeah.
Right.
I mean,
it was a
shock. You jump back, but it was like, I didn't want that payoff. I don't
right.
want to see the
you
monster.
You
want to
wonder. Well, and that was the thing.
Yeah.
You know, like the Blair Witch. I remember that movie affected
yeah.
me deeply when
yeah.
I saw it. And it was that same thing that. You know, and at that point, it was, everyone knew that it was a movie. You know, like when they said,
see,
when
that
they,
wasn't my experience.
Right, you saw
yeah.
it as like, this is found
we saw
footage.
It as a found
right.
footage videotape. Tess, and it was presented to her that way. And the first time I saw it was that way also.
And that's crazy. Like, to see
yeah.
it that way, it must have been terrifying. But, yeah, to see it as, just going into it knowing, like, just that idea that
mm-hmm.
this really happened, you know. Like,
yeah.
Here's what it is, and we're just going to show you the footage, and you make up your mind as to what happened, right?
Uh-huh.
That's a terrifying thing, because it
mm-hmm.
leaves so much. If they sit down and they spell out exactly what, well, this is how this person died, and this is how, you
mm-hmm.
know, it's not shown. Like, the one guy just disappears,
mm-hmm.
you know, and then, like, parts of him show up, and
mm-hmm.
you just go, but it's not really clear what that is, right? Like, is
mm-hmm.
that him? Is that...
Yeah.
You know, like, it's not
mm-hmm.
not super clear. So,
it's that lack of clarity, but it's like enough to arouse one's curiosity, yeah. but not enough to.
Well, because your brain starts to fill in the gaps.
Yep.
And what and your brain comes up with stuff that's far scarier mm-hmm. than anything else.
Yeah.
So I don't know if you can do that today. I mean, I think you have to work around it, and I think like the reviews I've read of Get Out.
Mm-hmm.
Which I don't know if you've...
I know, but I'm a huge Jordan Peele fan, and Key and Peele were fantastic. It for me, and apparently he's going to do 4 more horror films.
Really?
All this stuff, it's
widely acclaimed.
Yeah, and he made it for a relatively modest budget, and apparently doing quite well. Couldn't be happier. Those two, to me, just redefined comedy there a few years ago.
But yeah, they
ran just long enough, yeah.
And I think, I think he's really thrown his hat in the ring as to, like, this is how you can do horror now.
Yeah.
Like, this is, you can approach horror from this other direction that people haven't thought about.
I have to see it. Now I have to see that and have to see Logan.
Logan was really good. Yeah, I highly recommend. Don't take your kids. It's not your typical superhero movie. Like, the kids in, I can't imagine. If the kids who I saw in the movie theater were not traumatized by what they saw, then I have no idea what kind of house they live in. Because it was,
I shouldn't be laughing at that. But, yeah.
Yeah, and it makes some decisions. Uh-huh. Like, you meet some secondary characters who are just like the nice folks on the side of the road who, want to help out, and like they get eviscerated.
Wow.
Like, I mean, it makes some very strong very decisions. Strong decisions. Yeah.
Huh.
Yeah.
a few weeks ago, Tim Ferriss had a young comedian on, or not a terribly young comedian, a comedian, Jared Carmichael, who's gotten popular.
Yeah.
And I do have HBO, and HBO, he just has premiered his new special. So I sat down and watched it the other night. I really liked it.
Yeah, I've heard good things about it. I haven't seen it yet, but
he's got a very almost laid back approach to comedy. Like, he's not aggressive and energetic and stuff, and he'll take just long contemplative pauses.
Right.
And I mean, it really starts the show with just him.
Yeah, I'm just gonna look.
I'm doing something physical for the microphone, so you can all see what I'm doing. But yeah, just I quite liked it. So that's on my record.
That's pretty cool. Yeah, I'll have to check it out.
It's hard to see. It's hard to, stand up's a tough gig now. There's not a
it
lot
really
that
is,
it's what hasn't been done.
It's so hard to. It's so hard to find some niche that hasn't been occupied by someone at this point.
Yeah.
It's interesting. I'll have to look it up.
I like that one a lot. So no improv this week.
I know, which is a bit of a downer.
Did you feel the lack of improv this week?
I guess it hasn't really fully hit me yet, but yeah. To some degree.
Because it should have happened last night.
Yeah. Should have been last night. So
I think we're going to go to Monday nights, too.
Monday nights.
I think this is how it's going to go down. I think we're going to do Monday nights at QCP for the adults.
Okay.
And then I'm going to try a Thursday night in Frostburg for the kids.
Okay.
At a different thing. So that's sort of, and I'll confirm that when it is confirmed. But that's that's the general plan for it. But next week is spring break, so I'm not sure if we'll do the adults next week again also because of that. But
it'll be fun. Anyway. No, I'm looking forward to it. And I think I think with the adults, because we're doing like an hour and a half, and I think we could easily go 2 hours, I think.
Yeah, for the adults, I want to go to 2 hours and keep the kids at 1.5 is just enough for the kids.
Yeah.
I think the adults need to expand out to 2 hours.
Yeah.
So.
No, it was great. I'm looking forward to get back into it.
Cool.
It's nice to have a week off, and we had snow, and it's been just...
Yeah, that's been the big news around here. Like,
if it's still snowing, you will probably have to drive me home. I'll get back down the mountain.
Well, the funny, the big East Coast snowmageddon that was supposed to hit on Tuesday really kind of missed most everybody, but nothing really... And even around here, there was a certain... Like, they called off school...
Way in advance.
Everything's canceled. College is canceled. The local schools are canceled.
Right.
Everything is shut down. They just said, this thing is going to happen. It showed up many hours later, And it essentially snowed all night.
Yeah.
And by the morning it was tapering off. But, you know, we got, anywhere between 8 and 12 inches.
Yeah. Yeah.
And the general feeling was like kind of disappointment. Like, that wasn't that bad.
The weirdest thing was in Cumberland, it was right around freezing. Like, the temperature never really dropped super low. And so by noon, 1 o'clock, the roads were clear.
Uh-huh.
Everyone sort of shoveled out and kind of went about their business. And, you know, side roads were still a little dodgy, but the snow was melting off the cars and melting off the houses.
But then what happened is the temperature took a sharp drop.
Right.
And it's down in the teens right now and blowing around and apparently accumulating more. Karl bit off more than he could chew
a little with the drive here. Coming up the mountain until I got to just past Eckert as I was coming into Frostburg. It's a whole other world when you get into Frostburg. Like city limits, it's like they turn on the snow machine.
And it's like if you continue up the mountain, up into Finzel, and then Garrett County, then you're in Kaiser's Ridge and the Wisp, like this just, the gradations continue to escalate.
I can only imagine what Terre Haute is like.
Oh, yeah.
Grown up. Well, you know, that was the weird thing. I thought about that, too, because you and I have talked how winters are not like winters used to be growing up.
No, it used to be like this for months.
If this was as much snow as you got in one storm, you got off pretty easy.
Yeah.
Like a storm like this, they wouldn't have even canceled school when I was growing. Like, not to be like the old man when I grew up.
Back when I did. Well, I hate that climate change has become a political issue, but the climate has changed in Frostburg, Maryland. I can't speak for the rest of the country, but. You know, winter used to start in October and go through, late March, early April. We really didn't get anything this year. I mean, we got one or two light snowfalls. And then we got this mid-March blizzard 4 days or 2 days after it was 70 degrees.
Well, in Terre Haute growing up, they used to say in the 50s and 60s in Terre Haute, they billed it as the town that in the summertime you had to sleep with an extra blanket.
Mm-hmm.
In the summer, if you had your windows open, because it would actually get down, in July.
The temperature swing.
Well, like I remember, there was a 4th of July. Literally the 4th of July, our youth group had a stand where we sold Coke and popcorn and snow cones, and we would raise money for our mission trips or whatever for the 4th of July. And 4th of July in Terre Haute is a big deal, and so we woke up on the morning of 4th of July. And it was 38 degrees.
Wow.
And sleeting. And we went to, like, they did the car show that morning, and we were making coffee and hot chocolate to give to people because it was so cold. Like, we were waiting for it to start snowing on the 4th of July.
Now, that I've never heard that before.
And I mean, we didn't have a lot of that, but, we certainly had, and you never knew. There would be some years where Halloween, it would be 60 degrees. Mm-hmm. And you could run around in short sleeves. And there were Halloweens where you were wading through snow to get, to go trick-or-treating.
Wow.
It was just, Terre Haute is its own world.
Well, it sounds like it.
But but it's very different than what it was.
That's nuts. Yeah. Did you listen to any My Brother and Me this week?
I did not. I actually watched some of their CISO show. Some clips from their CISO show. And it's very funny. I mean, it is very funny stuff. They have this thing, I guess, in Huntington called Safety Town, where they teach kids how to drive, and it's like a miniature city with miniature roads, and they've got like little kind of go-karts.
Oh my God.
And so you have to drive through town, and they have stop signs and teach you, the rules of the road. And so the one brother's driving around, and the other two are dressed up like cops, and they keep harassing him, And then they're like in a high speed chase around Safety Town, to the point that they actually get kicked out. And then they have to like go apologize to the city of Huntington. They're like, "We are so sorry to the city of Huntington that we brought shame to Safety Town." it's funny stuff.
I have to see. I'm still trying to figure the thing I'll say about My Brother and Me is I'm in admiration of what they've done.
Yes.
They are non-celebrities who have launched themselves into a successful undertaking, starting with a podcast. Now they've got a show and everything else. I'm really in admiration of that. Their comedy's kind of hit and miss with me. I can't decide.
Yeah, it really it's kind of hit or miss for me as well. Like I will say when it's funny. I mean when it hits me, mm-hmm. it is hysterically funny. Like tears rolling down my face. Funny. Uh-huh. But yeah, if it's not working, it's just not working. Like I have to just go. Okay.
Well, they just I feel like in that they just keep plowing through it. There's something that's very bold, unafraid, unapologetic. Right. They just keep going, and that's where it's a little bit like Comedy Bang Bang.
Yeah,
is they'll just keep beating it. Just it's keep going. With Comedy Bang Bang, it seems to work more of the time than it doesn't.
Right.
I think with My Brother and Me, it works less of the time than it does, but when it does work, and again, just the fact that these guys have done this in Huntington, West Virginia,
it's crazy.
Which I'm in admiration of that model, and I hope that you know, very seriously, some of the things about the you know, the movie Oscar scratched on the door to be left out, and now he's scratching on the door to be left back in.
Right,
but you know, one of the things that we're really working to do now with the movie Brewdio is to build a podcasting network here.
Right, yeah.
Because that's kind of, that's where podcasting is going. I mean, everybody's getting bought up by networks and building networks.
Yeah.
And so that's the intention here. There will be additional podcasts. This is kind of the flagship, the big general podcast for the movie Brewdio. But we do have some other things in the works that hopefully we'll be putting out here in the next couple of months. And I don't know. I've certainly had a good time doing it.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
all right. Well, I feel like, so locally, culture-wise.
Yeah.
So Thursday night comes along, and Benjamin and I have something to do, Tess went to see Buddhist Monks over at Frostburg State.
Yeah, FSU, right, yeah.
Yeah, and I just thought it was just the most interesting thing. Here we are in small town Western Maryland. We have Buddhist monks hanging out here.
And they were doing, they did a, what's it, a mandala?
They did a huge mandala, however pronounce that, that they carved out of sand. Or whatever that was up. And this whole event had been going on for a week or two. And I'm over on the campus several times a week. And so I've seen them walking around in their monks and stuff. It was very cool.
We saw the, when I went to Lollapalooza 96 at the Charlestown Raceway in Charlestown, West Virginia. Which, if you go to Charlestown now, Charlestown, Shepherdstown, Martinsburg are really kind of exurbs of DC, like the DC suburbs have expanded where in 96
you're talking Charlestown,
West Virginia, like not Charleston,
Charlestown.
Yes,
I got mixed up when you said that before.
Charlestown.
Gotcha. Yeah.
So with the in 96, it was kind of out in the middle of nowhere, and Martinsburg was much the same. Now it's like Fredericksburg, even Winchester, Martinsburg. They're all considered easily drivable to D.C. if you work in D.C. So it's grown up a lot, yeah. And so we were out in the middle of nowhere at the Charlestown Raceway, and we're watching, we're there to see all the different bands. Metallica and Soundgarden co-headline.
Yeah.
It's the Ramones farewell concert. Rancid was on that bill.
Mm-hmm.
I went and saw Ben Folds Five there. They're fantastic. And one of the acts, Wu-Tang Clan was there. Yeah, we talked about Wu-Tang Clan before.
I was just re-listening to that podcast. Yeah. It's funny.
And one of the other acts there was the Shaolin Monks. Right?
On Lollapalooza.
And it was kind of right around that time where, you know, like the Tibetan Freedom concert, because it was like maybe 2 years later, so it was starting to kind of grow into consciousness of,
right,
and that was sort of like their goodwill tour where they were doing stuff, and they're doing like their full like like Zen, you know, whatever, focus your chi and bend a sword and, you know, like, you know, all these different feats of strength and stuff where, and it was really interesting. And there's like, there's a couple guys who have obviously been drinking and smoking pot all day.
Right.
At the Charlestown Raceway.
The monks were?
No, no, no. These guys, these guys in the crowd kind of where I, you know, near where I was. And they're losing their minds. I mean, Because it's stuff like, you know, they take like a sword, you know, and they're like, you know, he's going to like focus his chi on his stomach, you know, on his abdomen.
Yeah.
And then they try and stab him with a sword and the sword bends. Right. Wow. Uh-huh. And these guys are like, oh my God, did you see it? Yeah. Oh my God, it's the sword bent. Oh, I mean, they're freaking out. Like they've never seen anything like this, you know. And being chemically altered, I think, probably helped a lot.
Well, I'm sure, but that is some impressive stuff.
And that was probably the most, that was probably the closest thing to a cultural event for those guys. Like, I remember when they opened the first Chinese restaurant in Kingwood, West Virginia.
Uh-huh.
So not Terre Haute where I grew up, but down the mountain in Kingwood, in the county seat of Preston County, opened their first Chinese restaurant. And I go in and to pick up an order. And there's this guy yelling at one of the cooks going, "Hey! You got any more of that suey sauce? I love that suey sauce." And I was like, "Oh," and I'm like, and I'm like looking at all the like these poor, you know, Chinese people, and I'm just like, "I'm so sorry.
I'm sorry.
It's not suey sauce. Yeah. I know that's not correct."
Yeah. So, do you have a kindness award for the week?
You know, I got a good one this week. Do you have a good one this week?
I got a great one this week.
I will give the kindness award this week, I will say, to... you know, I had a great time going with Adam and Mark to go see Logan the other night, because it was a just kind of guy's night out. We're going to go see a guy movie.
Yep.
And, you know, when we kind of hemmed and hawed because we weren't sure, you know, when the snow was going to start, that sort of thing.
Yeah.
I'm glad we went. We had a really good time. It was nice just hanging out with bros for
sure.
But I don't get a lot of bro time. So it was good.
Cool.
All right. So what do you got?
Well, it kind of starts out sad. There was this the young local girl who was went to Mountain Ridge. I guess she graduated last year.
Right.
There was a horrible accident. She went to college down in North Carolina, Elon University, I believe. And she's a runner, and she's out running and was hit by a car.
Awful.
And
terrible.
She is in critical condition. She is on, you know, she's in a medically induced coma, last I heard.
Poor kid.
And so, yeah, tough time. Local family here. I believe her father works at the college. I don't know him personally. But anyway, this happened, and so locally, everybody says, say your prayers, all this stuff. Well, on Facebook, I believe it was Jeannie Wilodkin, started a Facebook group, Show Us Your Shoes. And just as like this local show of support, people are taking their running shoes and hanging them on the door, you know, like I said, sending prayers, positive thoughts, whatever you have, but as a show of local show of support, hanging running shoes on front doors, front porches, lamp posts, wherever you can hang shoes. Well, it has quickly become this phenomenon.
Right.
And there's, you know, they started a Facebook group and the numbers went up. I think they're over 3,000 members now.
That's awesome.
There are people in several countries. I want to say it's 6 different countries now hanging their shoes on their door. I think we're in 35 states now.
Wow.
Of this, you know, it when things happen, you know, there's always... I think people sometimes feel really powerless. What can I do? I can say a prayer.
Yeah.
You know, can I write a check? Can I, you know, what can I do here to make myself feel better? And I, you know, as much as I complain sometimes about social media and the negative effects, when I see things like this happen, it warms my heart that, you know, social media is being used for something positive. And, you know, the father has responded several times and, you know, expressed how grateful he is, you know, that this is going, and the kindness of the group is overwhelming. It's just some, it's, kindness goes both ways. And like I said, in these situations, sometimes we feel powerless to be able to do something, and there's just a simple little physical action.
Right.
But it speaks so well of the people in this area.
Yes, that absolutely.
Initiate something like this, that would participate in something like this. My old partner Ty made a video about the whole thing that plays on the Facebook page. So if you're on Facebook and you're not aware of that, there's a Show Us Your Shoes. The young lady's name is Molly Offstein. And so positive thoughts, yeah, prayers, all those kind of things are appreciated, but you can participate in this as well.
Yeah, and I think it's good to, you know, I think sometimes it's so hard to orchestrate something like this can be, I think, incredibly helpful for the family.
Yeah.
Because you don't know what to say sometimes, you know, or you don't know the situation, but you don't know the family well enough to go up and say, hey, look,
yeah,
can I do anything? And it's a way to just say, look, I'm thinking about your daughter. I'm praying, I'm sending good, positive thoughts your way. And it's a visible way to show that. And I think that could be an incredible meaningful thing, because you also don't want to, you walk that line between saying, well, I want, you know,
sometimes when you're in a situation, you just want to be left alone.
Right. You know, it's hard enough without people dropping by all the time going, how is everything? How's it, you know, you don't want to have to live it every minute, every day.
And it also kind of centralizes information too, because rather than having thousands and thousands of people saying, how is she? What's going on? We can give reports as there's reports to give, and
right,
I appreciate your support. Here's what's going on right now, and kind of makes the, you know, gives a kind of a focal point to everything. I don't know. There's just so much positive about it, but it is kind of a thing. It really just speaks of the kind of people that we have around here, the kind of community we have around here, everybody's level of support. I do know there is I think it's a GoFundMe campaign that I believe originally started as a $20,000 goal. I saw several days ago there was already $36,000 in it. So
that's awesome.
They're, you know, speculating that when she pulls through this, there's going to be some a long term recovery.
It's a long journey from back. It
seems
back.
Like there's going to be that. So they're already thinking ahead to that and collecting some money for that. So if you're a person of means, you can certainly contribute to that as well. But anyway, I mean that as a big general kindness for all the people in the area. I think they kind of get the kindness award for that.
Nice. Very good.
Awesome. Yep. Well, on that happy note, I think that's about what we got this week.
Yeah, I think we're good.
Yeah.
I got to figure out how to get back to Cumberland.
Oh, we'll get you. I got a four-wheel drive. We'll get you back to Cumberland.
I don't know.
I can't tell.
I'll have to go peek at the road. It was bad because I felt like, you know, driving up, I was like, if I run into bad weather, you know, we may just have to do it Thursday or Friday or something. And then, it was good, literally all the way until this, like, Frostburg city limits.
Yep.
And then at that point, I was like, well, I'm already here and I can't. Like,
there's nothing you can do in a couple hours. You're stuck. Let's keep podcasting for a couple more hours.
Just live stream. We'll go live with this. Yeah, exactly.
All right. Well, let's wrap it up.
Right.
Once again, I'm JW.
I'm Carl.
And this has been the Movie Brewdio Podcast with JW and Carl, episode number 13.
Lucky 13.
Lucky number 13 is the official, first official one that's going to get posted straight to. And I'll still do YouTube for a couple of more weeks.
Yeah.
But eventually we will be just posting to iTunes, probably in the next 3 or 4 weeks. We'll seg over to that for the full time.
Cool.
So if you're listening to us on YouTube, you might want to look into you in iTunes.
Yes. Or go to the moviebrewdiopodcast.com.
You can go to themoviebrewdiopodcast.com. So as we're so fond of saying, Carl,
yes,
that's it
for it.
See you next week, everybody.